Good afternoon. Thank you very much for having us here. Also, thank you very much for the Discovery Cube for having us here. I'm Zeno Gerards of the Netherlands Forensic Institute, and one day a week I'm at the University of Amsterdam as a professor on digital and biometric traces, and I'm also president of the American Academy of Forensic Science. I would like to talk about the use of artificial intelligence in forensic science, from deepfake to big data analysis. And we'll go through some of it. I will show you some deepfake, some deep learning, and other things that we can do with artificial intelligence. And I will also get into issues that there are with intelligence, with artificial intelligence. I'm from the Netherlands Forensic Institute. The NFI has around 600 people working there. And we have around 100 people on digital evidence. We have 15 data scientists that are on artificial intelligence for forensic science. If we look into the artificial intelligence, a definition is that artificial intelligence is the simulation of human intelligence processes by machines, especially computer systems. And these include learning, the acquisition of information and rules for using the information, reasoning, and self-correction. So that's the Turing criterion. It was found by Turing, who was in the Second World War. He was doing crypto analysis for the United Kingdom. What's new with deep learning? In the past, we had machine learning. And machine learning was that if you have a car like that, you see the wheels, you see the windows. And then a human would say, okay, this, we have these features like the wheels, and we classify it. And then based on the classification, we have we recognize these features, and then we say, oh, it's a car. With deep learning, you just give some examples to the system. So you train it with many different cars other pictures of you can train it with millions of pictures of different objects, and then it will learn itself with this network that it's a car based on the training input. So you will have maybe 1,000 images of cars, and it will learn, okay, this is a car, and then it will train an airplane, and that's the way it works. So it will train that it is a car, or an airplane is not a car. So, and that's the way how deep learning modifies the world. That's with neural networks, so they will work with many layers inside of that. And with the current computers, you can easily calculate these kind of training models. And if we have digital evidence nowadays, you might have also lots of artificial intelligence that's in your drone, perhaps. So it will also learn from, you might have a self-driving car, and that is also based on artificial intelligence. So we see lots of examples of artificial intelligence that you have already. Perhaps on your phone, you might also have AI on it. For digital evidence, we can also use it as evidence as such. Right? So all the information you have on your phone might be used later on as evidence for the court. So if you ever make a picture or something else, that can be used as evidence in the court. Or your location, of course, that's also very important. So we are sitting here now, and your location is also stored on the network, but also on your phone. So that's also a way to track that you were maybe in this room. But we have lots of traces. If you look on the internet, the number of traces that you have and that you collect each day that's huge. So maybe you don't realize it, but you have lots of traces that you generate if you have your mobile phone or if you use your computer or perhaps all cameras that are around us. They might make pictures and you might combine all this data. And then you have big data, so that's lots of volume, lots of velocity, a variety of data and veracity. This is according to Gartner. So, and that's something we have to deal with because there is lots of traces in it. There's also some discussion about big data. Big data might be also that everything big data claims to know about you could be wrong because it's based on the average and not on the personal person as such. So this is something to be aware of. And there is lots of big data, that you can collect and that you can find. And privacy is, of course, one of those issues. I mean, in most countries, only the evidence from your phone, for example, can be taken from your phone by court order or by a warrant. And we see also other things in AI, like crime prediction on where a crime might happen in the future. And then they might use that as information to put additional protection in that part of the city. If we look into forensic analysis, you see that you have lots of data, big data. And currently, in the past 20 years ago, it had a throughput of months. And now we see with the newest systems that you have a throughput of hours. So data from your mobile phone, from all computer systems, might be processed. This is valuable as evidence. And of course, privacy is important. So the analyst can directly search through the data that's collected for that purpose. But problem with data is, of course, your data on your phone, you might make a picture, but did you make your picture yourself? Or what kind of scenarios did it have? So you might have a timeline, when something happened. So if you were at a crime scene and you were making a photograph of that, then you might have a timeline of different pictures that you made, or perhaps a video you made. You might have the information where the cell phone was at a given moment. And of course, we do analysis of video, images, speech analysis, speech recognition. And nowadays, with new software, there's also artificial intelligence in those kind of methods, like author recognition. So then it will learn also based on examples that you wrote a certain email, and then it gives a certain likelihood ratio that you wrote that email. And speaker recognition, that's the same thing. So there are also automated systems for doing that can assist the forensic analysts. Things that we also do at the NFI is, for instance, if you have lots of information on your mobile phones or other things, and there might be a crime happening, that it will search for firearms so in the data. That's also like the car that I showed. It's also the way you search through the data. And you have to be aware of bias. There are some discussions that the most of those algorithms were trained on Caucasian males. So there are some privacy issues there. Nowadays, we see that the best algorithms for facial comparison, so the Microsoft in the last NIST test really outperformed the human being in facial recognition. So that was one of the things that we saw. And now we are going into some examples of faces that do not exist. Do you think this person exists? No, it's fake. It's based on AI algorithm. It's just a generated face. So it learned from examples of many pictures, and then it generated this this face. And that makes also for forensic evidence, it makes it complicated, because then you have to recognize that this is really fake. And we see that lots of fake images are being made as such, so you can also find them on the internet easily, and they are getting much better. So in the last years, we see that the fake images, like at the right here, the resolution was quite low, but now it's getting really high resolution and it's difficult to detect. So it's here we see all fake images, people that do not exist. And you can just go to the website thisfacedoesnotexist.com, and then you will see all faces. That it generates each time a new face that does not exist. How well can people detect that a face is real or not? Not very good. So we see that we tested this with people that are AI experts, and they, in general, they had 70% scored correctly that it was fake, but they also 70% correctly that it was not fake. So that's some of those things that we look at. Now we are going to the deep fakes. The deep fakes as such, I can show you some example.
When there's so many haters, I really don't care, because their data has made me rich beyond my wildest dreams. My decision to believe in Spectre literally gave me my ratings and my fan base. I feel really blessed because I genuinely love the process of manipulating people online for money.
I'm sorry, Lester, this is going so well. It's going exactly how I'd always dreamed.
Okay, here's you, right? Red Jarrett, get it? Okay, here's your cash. You're out on the town. Yeah? You're partying hardy, grabbing of the chicky babes. Well, who's this? It's the tax man.
So also the voice is also faked as such. And you can also see later on in this video that you might have those of presidents and others that can be faked. And you can also do it yourself. Part of it is done with morphing. So we have morphing of faces. And this is also something that is used in passports at the border. At least in many countries, you can just submit your photograph yourself, and then there are criminals that use those submissions to make a morph of two faces. So we morph this face on the left with the morph with the face on the right, and then you get an average face as such that is an average of those persons. And problem is with the border control that they don't see it, because they if this person will be at the border or that person, they might not see the difference. And that's also with algorithms, they also do not see the difference. So that's one of the issues that we currently have. And there were some terrorist cases, at least in the Netherlands, where they tried to get through border control like that. So we see several examples here. So question to you, is the person in the middle a morph or not? Who thinks it's a morph? It's, in this case, it's not a morph. In the next case, do you think it's genuine? So the one in the middle, is it a morph or not? That's one is a morph, and so we continue. So it's not easy to detect if it's a morph or not in general. And we did also some research on that by making morphs ourselves. So you can just make the morphs quite easily also with software on the internet. So you can make them also on your phone. So then we just have two pictures of two different persons, and then we try to morph them to get a new picture that will work on both. So they have to look somewhat similar, but we see that here we see examples of morphs, and then we try to find out how well we could detect that they were morphs or not. So that's another research set that we did, so to detect automatically with deep learning and with artificial intelligence how well they can be detected. So we trained the algorithm with false negatives and false positives and true negatives, and then it appeared that in 95% of the cases we could find out that it was a morph. But the humans are also quite bad in detecting that it's a morph, so you really need to look at this kind of evidence. So I will continue with the deepfake and the deepfake detection. So as I said already, so Nicolas Cage, that's based also on videos, so you can just do it on your own computer. You can make your own deepfake, so you can have your own face projected on Nicolas Cage or whoever you want to make a morph with. And that's all based also on artificial intelligence. So it's all based on those neural nets networks that I just discussed. It will if you have a full frontal image of a face, you can just project your own face on that or another face. And you see lots of examples on the internet with presidents and other people that they make deepfakes of, and they can also manipulate the audio, so they can also make the president say things that he really didn't say. So how do you make those deepfakes? You can just download software from the internet. Deepfake Lab is one of the examples. And then you can make those deepfakes. So you have to train it with some examples of your face, and you have to need to have maybe 20 minutes of video of a person and of yourself, but 5 minutes will also work, and then you can train the algorithm and you can make your own deepfakes. I tested this with some students, and they could within half a day they could make quite good deepfakes as such. Why do we want to research this for forensic purposes? Because it's expected that many suspects will say that all their video was deepfake or was manipulated. And that's what we see in court happening more often, that people say, yes, all my evidence was fake. So that is something that we have to prove that it's not fake. Here you have this software, an example, but you have many more where you can just enter the different examples and you can make your own deepfakes. We have several methods, but I won't go in depth on those methods to detect if they are deepfake. And one of the good methods that we have is a kind of fingerprint of the camera that we use. So if you have your photo camera, then it has a kind of fingerprint in it on the sensor, and then we can detect that it was made with that camera. So it's the photo response non-uniformity. It's just based on the production of a CCD sensor, the sensor of your photo camera, where it just has slight differences in the manufacturing process. So each pixel responds somewhat differently. And that appeared to work quite well for PRNU analysis of deepfake. Of course, with any method that we develop for detection, you can make your own fake PRNU patterns. That's always a problem with publishing about new methods, then people can also make their compensate for that. So we are working further on this kind of research. And so if you want to, I just also made some deep fakes of my own face. So it's quite easy. Within one day you can train and you can average those fakes yourself with a deep face lab. And you can just use it on your Windows computer. And you need to have your graphical user card, it's GPU on your computer that will run for a long time. But after one night of computing, it will make a nice deep fake of your yourself. And now we see also that on Gaggle there's a competition, so you can earn $1 million if you can detect if you're best to detect deep fakes, because Facebook really wants us to detect it better. But it's a quite difficult problem, so many people are working on this, and the algorithms get better each year, so I expect it's not very easy to solve this problem. But we will get more deep fakes as such in the lab to examine, and we need to authenticate those. But of course it depends on, I mean, if you just have evidence from a CCTV, then it's less likely that it's been deep faked, of course, if it's just a chain of evidence is there. But for instance, we also had a case with the MH17 that was shot down in the Ukraine, and there of course the images that were made were by private persons, and then you get more often these kind of questions: is this real or not? So that's something to see in practice. We see that we need to also train people on using artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence is available in many products, and you have to interpret everything correctly. And with some of those products, it appeared that there were some misleading evidences since people were not trained correctly. So we need to be sure about machine learning solutions, ranking and sorting. Bias is one of the things that are discussed. The training of the persons that are using these algorithms, that's one thing that we have to consider. And detecting that artificial intelligence has been used for deepfakes is one of those things that we need to address. And of course, we see that deep learning, explaining deep learning in court, is also one of the issues that we are looking further into. So there is lots to be examined here, and it's a nice field at least. I like the field very much as an examiner to look to the different options and how to detect it. So there is lots of research capacity needed for that. So we can also use artificial intelligence in the to find also deviations of certain court rulings. So that's also a project I'm involved in. So to use artificial intelligence as such. So many different possibilities, and but we should validate those. I think that will conclude my talk. This is the Netherlands Forensic Institute in The Hague. So I would like to thank you very much for your attention. And I think we continue now with Dr. Ropero Miller, and she will talk about more information. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to echo Zeno in saying that every year the American Academy of Forensic Science has an annual meeting, and this year it just happened to be in Santa Ana, and we were able to partner with the CUBE to come and speak to you today about some of the forensic disciplines that are in in the American Academy of Forensic Sciences. So right now we have about 11 sections, and he talked to you about digital and multimedia sciences. And my background is I'm a researcher in forensic toxicology. So in forensic toxicology, we're looking at how poisons or drugs contributed to a person's behavior or impairment, how they contributed to a death, how they contributed to a crime. And so with that being said, I wanted to focus on something that we hear about in the news probably on a daily basis now, and that's the opioids crisis or the opioids epidemic in America, and talk a little bit about its impact on the forensic sciences. So I'm not gonna get into how we do our science necessarily, but how what we do actually goes hand in hand with things like an epidemic. So with that being said, I think I just hit this one, but essentially with what we do, the opioids crisis is mutually inclusive with its impact of what we do and its impact on the nation. A little bit just to put everybody on the same page, give you a couple of definitions of what a drug and opiates and opioids are. A drug can be any kind of chemical that's not a food that's going to affect your body in some way. Most of the drugs that we think about are actually drugs that are given to people by their doctors. So it's to help them take care of a disease or to take care of an illness. But there's also, in addition to these medicines or prescription drugs, there are drugs that are illegal. There's no reason to necessarily be taking those. And therefore, they are a crime in most cases to have. And we as forensic scientists do identify both types of drugs because, of course, you could be taking a prescription drug, but it could, in some events, lead to a death, for instance. Opioids are any natural substance that comes out of the poppy plant. And you can see up there in the right, a poppy plant or a poppy flower is a really nice flower. They're grown all over the world. And they act on the brain to give different types of effects, whether it's euphoria or you feel good. But many times they're used for medicine because they help with pain. For these poppies, while they're grown all over the world, and you can have opiates such as morphine and codeine and those types of drugs that are given in a prescription, there's many that are illegal and they have no reason to be used, such as heroin. And then in addition to these natural substances, we have opioids, and that's what I'll be talking about today. And these are synthetic or semi-synthetic, meaning that we, humans, make them. So they're not made in nature, but we mimic them. We make them so that they're going to give the same effect as what you would see with an opiate. And these poppies are even grown in my state, in North Carolina. This was a recent posting where they were found and they were illegal, and the local authorities had to go in and remove them. So what is the opioids crisis and why is it synonymous with an epidemic? When we think about an epidemic, it can be anything that is disproportionately large and it affects a large number of individuals. Or it can be rapidly spreading, or the growth of it is just kind of getting out of hand. It's happening too much. And then there can even be the epidemics, usually they're harmful in one way or the other, and they spread or develop rapidly, such as a crime epidemic, or in this case, a drug epidemic. And as you can see here, you start with an outbreak. So many of us every year suffer from a flu, we get sick, and these outbreaks happen every year. They can quickly become an epidemic or even a pandemic where they're spreading to be all over the world. So when you think of flu, every year for the last 10 years, it's resulted in 12,000 to 61,000 deaths. in the U.S. alone. And we're hearing in the news right now that coronavirus is out there. And it just started showing up in the news in December, the last of December. And we're already at a epidemic of the coronavirus and quickly being identified as possibly moving into a pandemic. So why is this important? We see it in the news. You can see that the opioids epidemic is leading to a lot of bad things, whether it's deaths or crimes or what have you. So just to put it in perspective, when we looked at 2017, car crashes were less than those that were dying of an overdose, the same as HIV and firearms. So we've gotten to a really large number, and that's why it is called an opioid epidemic. And it's not just synthetic opioids or heroin. Many of your prescribed opioids that are given as medicines are contributing to this as well. The CDC, which looks at disease and things like that that are happening in the United States, they started looking at the numbers. And you can just see from this that they put out in 2018 that it is indeed getting to be an epidemic issue. But it's not just in the U.S. that it's problematic. It is a global thing. We look at, in 2017, 35 million people worldwide suffered from drug use. And that only 1 in 7 were receiving treatment for this. And when you look at the deaths in the worldwide due to opioids, the numbers are pretty high as well. You're looking at 500,000 drug deaths in 2017. And so that's where things start changing, or where you can see forensic science getting involved, because we participate in a lot of the research and the data that is needed to help with trying to right this situation that we have. But when we're looking at the opioids crisis and its effect on forensic sciences, it's really challenging for us because there's so many different opioids that are out there that we just can't identify them fast enough. They're coming out. In 2017, there were over 500 new drugs that were illicitly out there for us to deal with. And for every single one of those, we have to develop methods that can identify them so that we can say how they affected the case that we're working on. And this is a problem because it's a cat and mouse game. Everything is changing on a daily basis. What we learned yesterday and we put in place to be able to solve the problem today, tomorrow that answer is going to be different. So we're constantly having to redevelop our science, and it's very challenging. Just to talk about potency, and potency is just how well a drug is going to give you the effects that you're looking for. And down in the right-hand side, you see three opioids. And what we were dealing with just, not even 15 years ago, is a drug that took a lot to make somebody sick or die. And now there are drugs out there that are being available that when you look at comparison and you could like use a grain of salt, these drugs would be 1 grain of salt, whereas what we were dealing with 10 or 15 years ago would be 5,000 or 10,000 grains of salt. So the potency of these substances are much, much worse. So for forensic sciences, what I wanted to share with you today is that we do inform policies. Policies and laws are not going to go into place if we can't prove why they need to happen. And so a lot of the research that we're working on will help the government and individuals be able to determine what kind of laws need to be put into place to help us with the issues at hand with the opioid epidemics. In addition, forensic sciences can inform promising practices. We're not just about forensic science. Forensic science is heavily involved in public safety and public health. That's what we are, our profession is working for, are trying to help with achieving. And when we can do things analytically in what we do in our daily daily work, we can help inform surveillance of these substances as they are coming into the different countries. We can help inform on the crimes and how to deal with them. And then also we can help with patient interventions and treatment. So it's well beyond forensic science as far as what we can touch on. Zeno talked about computer search algorithms in his artificial intelligence, and this is very important for my field too. We're using artificial intelligence to help with drug intelligence. It's stuff that we don't necessarily know, but we can enter information into computer databases and try to get a handle on things that the computer can tell us what to predict. We also inform research and policy and practice. So we are always looking at scientific advancements to optimize our policies, as I discussed. So everything we do has to be evidence-based and it has to be actionable. If we can't prove it, just like in a court of law, then it's hard to make it lead to an action. And also forensic science is utilizing intelligence of other markets to provoke creative disruption. And what I mean here is we're not just looking at what we do in our environment and in our community. We're going in the criminal sense. We're looking at pharmaceutical companies and what they're doing. We're looking at what's happening in clinical settings or the health. We're looking even what's happening for human rights and humanitarian types of situations like trafficking, because that can give us information or drug intelligence in our daily lives as far as what we do. And as I said earlier, it is more than just in the U.S. that this is a problem, emerging drug threats. It really is a worldly approach that we have to look at. And forensic scientists every day are looking to help with things like eradicating drugs and their uses, are creating world or global stewardships, or changing laws that are at a worldwide level rather than at a country's level or a state level. And so I talked about how this opioid epidemic is affecting forensic science, but forensic science, I believe, is also impacting the opioid epidemic with the work that we're doing. We have been very responsive to these emerging drug threats, and we have been champions for the advancement of where it's going to lead to the future. But we still need to look at evidence-based strategies and global efforts to come up with resolutions to it in the future. So I showed at the beginning of the presentation a situation where we are looking at deaths in the U.S. in 2016. And I wanted to end just by saying a note of positivity that with the efforts that are coming together and all the work that's being done, that we're actually starting to see a shift. Hopefully it will continue to go. We can't tell by 1 year. But in 2018 was the first time that we had seen overdose deaths drop in the United States for the first time since 1990. And so that's all I have. And thank you for talking. Thank you.